go on with model checking, symbolic model checking. And what I'd like to do is to show how to do verification with SAT-based model checking. So yesterday we saw how to use bounded model checking and apply it with SAT. And what we could achieve is falsification, but not verification. We could find bugs, but we couldn't come into the conclusion that no bug appear in the system. So today I will show a specific solution for this problem, which is using interpolation sequence. And I will also go back to the very first work by Macmillan that introduced interpolation and how to use it for obtaining full verification with SAT. But my feeling is that this way it's easier to understand, but someone else can claim that we can explain it the other way around. Okay, so the SAT-based the SAT-based interpolation sequence model checking is inspired by forward reachability analysis. I will show in a minute what it means, but in general it means that we are, as we saw before, we start from the initial state, we go to the next state and the next and the next, and we are looking for a bug, and we can find a fixed point, which tells us that if we didn't find the bug so far, then we are safe and we can return the fact that we have a full verification. So this is what we have in mind, but we want to simulate it somehow within SAT. So we are going to alternate between bounded model checking. It, as before, will take the role of finding bugs, and between interpolation sequence, which will hold the set of states. So yesterday we had a question of why we do not hold set of states, and we said that it's impossible if the only question that we ask are satisfiability, but now we will say that we can use propositional formulas in order to represent set of states, and eventually we will able to conclude fixed point. We will able to we will be able to conclude that we saw all the reachable state in the system. So here is the forward reachability analysis. You saw it already many times in my talks. We have the bed states. This time it's not Q. And we start with the initial state, and now we take the successors, and the which is S1, and the successors of the successors, which is S2, and so on and so forth. And now the question is whether we will eventually hit this set of states, which means we have a bug, or we are not going to hit a set of states, which means that we are okay. So now we have, this will be very important now, the notion of Sj. It will be the set of state reachable from some initial state after exactly j steps. So this is how we now define Sj. And here, it's this is S1. These are the states that we reached by after one step. And this is S2. These are the states that we can reach after exactly two states, and so on. Okay, in order to determine in this setting termination, what we need to find out is that at some point we get to a set of states, Sj, which is completely contained in all the previous one. This means that we take a new step, but every state that we find now already appears previously, and therefore if we make more steps, then we are not going to see any new steps state anyway, and we can stop and we can conclude that we saw all the reachable states. And this is an important point. We are talking about finite state systems, and this gives us the guarantee for termination. If we take this whole idea and extend it to infinite state systems, then it's a completely different game, and the termination is not guaranteed, but also we are going to have problems with representing it as a pure propositional formulas. So we talk about propositional formulas. We are talking about finite state models. Everything can be lifted, but then we are encountered with different problems. Sometimes we could only use bounded model checking and find bugs, and then two very successful methods were suggested in order to do verification. One is using interpolation. I will introduce it at the end of the talk. And it was suggested by Macmillan in 2003. The other one is called IC3, sometimes it's called PDR, and it has been suggested by Bradley in 2011. Both are SAT-based. And what we are going to do is to first represent the interpolation sequence method and only later Macmillan's method. Okay, so a bit of intuition. What are we going to do? On the upper side, we just have the usual reachability over the set of the states of the system. So we have S1, we already know it. It's the set of states reachable after one step. And now what we are going to compute, instead of computing S1, sorry, we are going to compute some set of states, I1, which will be an over approximation of S1. And then what we were supposed to do is to compute S2, but instead we are going to compute a set of states I2, which is an over approximation of S2. And for S3, we are going to do it again, and so on. So here it is. It represents the fact that each one of the sets is an over approximation. And now let's assume that with the over approximation, we go to a fixed point. And when we got to a fixed point, we didn't hit any bad state. So actually, we are looking at an over approximation of the set of reachable states. And if this set didn't hit any bad state, it means that the original, the real reachable states do not hit bad states. And then we are fine. We can return the fact that this system is correct. What happens if, with the approximation, we hit a bad state? It might be spurious because it might go through some of the states that are not really reachable. And therefore, when we find such a counterexample, it might not be real. We call it spurious. This is why we still use bounded model checking as our tool for finding real counterexamples, and we are using this in order to keep track of what we saw already. Okay, so this is a good time to introduce what interpolation is. This is the basic notion of the whole idea. So interpolation has been suggested by Craig in 1957, and it has been suggested in the context of first order logic. We will be using it in the context of propositional formulas, but the definition is the same. So let's say that we have two formulas, A and B, and they are contradicting each other, their equivalent, their conjunction is equivalent to false. Then what Craig actually shows is that there is a formula of the logic, I, which has the following two properties. First of all, it is implied by I. Second, its conjunction with B is false. And the next one is that it is written over the common alphabet of A and B. So intuitively, what we have here is that I holds the explanation of why A and B are false. And this explanation takes the part of A that is relevant. So this is a very intuitive explanation, but it's kind of, it just takes the common alphabet between A and B, but it reflects the behavior of A, and it says this is the reason why they don't work well together. And here is an example. Let's say that A is P and Q, B is not Q and R. Then in this case, the interpolation will be Q. Notice that it is implied by A, and it is together with B, it is equivalent to false, and it is over the common alphabet, and this is exactly, it exactly gives the intuition that it explains why A and B cannot go together, but in a very limited way. So there are many, many works of how to compute interpolation efficiently once we have two formulas that are false together. And in principle, if we try to satisfy A and B, and the SAT solver have just return an unsat, the formula is not satisfiable, then many of the current SAT solvers not know how to efficiently compute an interpolation based on the proof of unsatisfiability. Yeah, we can view this proof as a resolution proof and from there extract the interpolation. I will not get into it at all. For me, I just know that I can get it, but it's from the practical point of view, it is important that it can be computed and that many of the current SAT solvers just give it. Okay, so let's look at bounded model checking. Here we have the usual formula for bounded model checking. It says that we are in the initial state first, and then we take a transition from 0 to 1, from 1 to 2, and so on. And we check whether there is a bug in the case place. So if this formula is satisfiable, then we found a bug. But if it's not, then we know that we have an interpolation. And this interpolation, this is what Macmillan suggested. He suggested to partition the formula in the following way. One part takes just the initial state and one step. The other part takes all the other steps and the bug, the representation of not P. And now, if we build an interpolation here, over which alphabet will it be? V1, which means that we will show it in more details, but actually it reflects the set of states that are reachable after one step. So this is the main point of interpolation. Later on we can extend it, but this set that we are going to have here is an over approximation of this set of states. So let's see what's, just recall the properties of the interpolation. We have an interpolation, it is implied by I, it contradicts B, and it is over V1. And now let's see what what the meaning is of these three properties. So the implication between A and I implies, actually think of implication between formulas in general. What it means that every assignment of A is also assignment of I. And if we now think of a formula as representing a set of assignment, this means that this set is a subset of this set. So if you now take the set of assignment here, restrict it to V1, and now we take the set of assignment of I, which is anyway for V1, then we see that this is an over approximation of this. Because we have here a set of states, actually the set of states reachable after one step, and now we get an over approximation of this set. So this is one very important property of the interpolation. It gives us an over approximation of the reachable states after one step. Another important property, which will come into effect in the second method that I will show, is that actually I together with B is false, meaning that from the states in I, we cannot reach a bug in k minus 1 steps. So let's go back to the formula. It means that if we take I, and now we take k minus 1 steps, and we get to not P, this whole formula is false, which means that going from I k steps will not give us P. Or in other words, we will get to a set of states that satisfy P. Okay, so now we want to extend this idea by using interpolation sequence. Interpolation sequence itself, again, was suggested by Macmillan in the context of software model checking, but we took it to the context of hardware or more general verification. There it was in a very specific way. And now what is the interpolation sequence? It takes the same formula, but it partitions it into more parts. So now we have k plus one part, and the claim is that we can have actually, here we have k interpolants, but we also have I zero and I k plus one. So we have k plus two interpolants. And now what we know about interpolants, and we can use it later on in verification, is that the left one is just true. The right one, which is not written, is just false. And for every other one, if we take a certain interpolant, the J minus one, we conjunct it with AJ, then it implies the IJ. And now let's see what it means in this context. In this context, let's take the first part. We are in true, so it means true, and this implies this. So this we already know. It I1 is exactly the over approximation of the set of states reachable after one step. So this is nothing new. It's exactly like before. But now what we have an over approximation of this of S1. Recall that S1 is the set of states reachable after one step. And we apply one step, and we get a set of states, which is again an over approximation, which means that this is an over approximation of the set of states reachable after one step. So in a sense, we got an over approximation. We made one step. Every successor of I1, which is an over approximation, is between I2, and here we may do some more over approximation, and so on and so forth. And we get here, and here we know that IK and not P implies false, which means that IK implies P. And this is also a very important point, because we know that the last one represents a set of states that are for sure true, do not contain a bug. So we are going to use this. So this is actually, it just summarizes everything that I described right now. And now just again, a technical point. If we now want to compute interpolation sequence, then what we do, we take the formula, we partition it to A1, AJ, AJ plus 1 to AN, and now we can just compute the interpolation in the same way. So it doesn't add any significant complexity to compute interpolation sequence instead of just interpolant. This one or the one before? It's just a conjunction of all the rest, from J plus 1 to AN. I just checked the formula. Let's go back here. So if I want to compute this interpolant, I am saying this is my A now, this is my B, and now this is a regular interpolant as before. And now I want to compute this, so I say this is my A and this is my B, and I do the same interpolation computation. I can use the same proof. So I have a proof that this formula is unsatisfiable, and I can use the same resolution proof in order to compute all the interpolants at the same time. So I will have the resolution tree, and I will just be able to do all the computation together. This is just the property of the interpolant. The interpolation sequence, it has been proven that this is the properties of interpolation sequence. It's just good for us because it means that this is an over approximation of the set of states reachable in one step from the previous set. Oh, why we get this?
I'm asking why does this the line before the IJ minus 1 and IJ implies IJ?
So this is a property of the interpolant. It's just you could say you could ask about the interpolant, the original interpolant, why it is implied by A and.
If you take AJ and BJ as you said, just the two parts of the formula.
Yeah.
It
is important that they are all computed from the same resolution tree. You're right, it's a good point. Yeah. Yes. I know, the question was, I have, in order to compute the interpolants, I anyway have to solve the property, the formula, and then anyway, I know that every assignment for VK doesn't satisfy P, right? This was the question. So the point is that when I have this representation, I don't have a representation for the set of states that are reachable after K steps. I have a long, very long a formula that describes how you can go from 0, 1, 2, 3 to P. No, what I want to do now with the interpolation is to have some representation for set of states and to be able to conclude that I got to a fixed point. This is the main point. I don't understand, sorry?
I think there is a confusion because of the negation and the quantifiers that are implicit here. So you want to say that there is no path of k step that reaches not p. It doesn't mean that there is a path that reaches p.
No. It does. No. This is not the case here because we are on the propositional level and what we want to know that I actually, I had such a strange, where do I have it? Oh, here. What I have. I said that IK do not violate P. But actually, it means that they satisfy P. If they do not violate, then they satisfy P because it's proposition. It can just be true or false. And if it doesn't satisfy P, then it satisfy not P. But it doesn't violate P, so it's like here. In any case, it satisfies P. But the main point here is that the interpolation gives us a representation of set of states, which we do not have when we look, when we have this view, we have a formula, and when we get an ansatz, then we do not get any additional information. We do know that there is no bug of length k, but we cannot hold in our hand the set of states that.
So the goal is not to give an answer there is no bug, but also to appear and see there is no bug.
Here is the set of states that are reachable. So the same way that in reachability we accumulated states and we could check that we saw them all, this is the goal of this part. And this is actually a great idea to hold it with interpolants. This was some brilliant idea of Macmillan to see that he can use the notion of interpolant that was very old and use it in this context to hold set of states. And here we just extend it to several sets, set of states that can help us more. Okay, so when the SAT solver actually gets the result that the formula is unsat, in principle you can view the SAT solver as doing some kind of backtracking, checking an assignment, see that it doesn't satisfy, go back and so on. So you can view it as just searching the tree. But another way is to take this proof and see it as a resolution proof. Well, resolution proof is more like a tree that tells you if you have this clause and this clause, then you can conclude this clause. And again, such solvers can transform the regular work to resolution proof. And from the resolution proof, you can extract these formulas that represent the set of states. No. You always can transform
so
and.
And they SAT solver construct resolution.
Yeah.
Or the CDC and solver construct resolution.
If you ask it, because if you it makes it slower. It can do it. They don't necessarily keep or a track of all the steps on the way. In principle, yes, because SAT solver in principle works exponentially hard, but in practice, in many cases, it is very fast. It gives us solutions, and then we can exploit them also to build the interpolation.
Just one last question.
Yeah.
When you apply the transition to get the don't have to recompute all the information. Okay. You have to recompute I1, I2, etc.
Yes, you do because
it's a different proof.
Yes, and then you do want all of them to be computed on the same resolution proof,
right,
in order to have all these nice properties. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we can use all kind of incremental model checking, incremental SAT solvers as so we exploit it. But I will not get into it at all. Okay, so altogether, to describe our methods, we are using BMC, or bounded model checking, for bug finding, and we are going to use interpolation sequence to over approximate the set of states Sj, of states reachable after j steps. And this method always terminates. Either it terminates because bounded model checking tells us that it found the bug, and then we can conclude that our system does not satisfy AGP, the invariant that P always holds, or we, at some point, we can conclude that we saw all the reachable states in the system, and therefore we can conclude that the structure satisfies AGP, and this is true only because our set of states is finite, and the method accumulates more and more states, and eventually it will get to a point where it says, I saw them all, and therefore there is no bug there. Okay, so let's see a little bit in some more details how the interpolation sequence works. So we first have the formula of bound K. So this formula just says we are in the initial state, we make one step, and we do not find the bug. And if this is unsatisfiable, then we find an interpolant. And what we know about the interpolant from the interpolation sequence is that it over approximates this set of states, and that all the states here satisfy P, because it does not violate P. This was this way to phrase it. So it does all of these states satisfy P. So now we extend the bound to 2, and let's say that we still didn't find the bug. And we are going to have 2 interpolants in the interpolation sequence. And now we know that this over approximates S1, this over approximates S2, and all of these satisfy P. So for this, we do not know that they satisfy P, but for this, we do know. So what we know that the set of successors of this one are here. So this will be also important. So now what we do, we conjunct or intersect, we track the intersection of the 2 interpolants that over-approximate S1. So what we have here are 2 sets of states. Both of them set over-approximate S1. And therefore, their intersection also over-approximate S1. So I have some over-approximation of S1, and now I get another over-approximation of S1. And if I now take only this, their intersection, then it also over-approximate S1, but it's even more concise, smaller. Another important part is that the first one, for the first interpolant, I knew that it satisfies P. I don't know it about the second interpolant because it was not the last in the sequence. But since I intersect them, I know that their intersection also set, satisfy P. So what I got here is a set of states that over approximate S1 and satisfy P. We'll go back. What I know about interpolation sequence is that they have this over approximation, and only about the last one I know that it satisfies P because it doesn't violate not P, it doesn't satisfy not P. Yeah? I can't hear you. Tell Javier and he will tell me. What? Yes, but they are formulas. Yes, they are set of states in the sense that if you if they represent the set of assignments that satisfy them, and instead of saying set of assignment, I say set of states, because
they don't have to be states of the system.
Ah, okay. This is a very good point. Yeah, we can view all the encoding of, I don't know, n variables, 2 to the n assignment as states, but not all of them are reachable. And since I take over approximation, clearly I get to non-reachable states. But it's easier to say all of them are states, and now I just, okay, good point. View what we have. Here we got an over approximation of S1, here we got an over approximation of S2, here of S1 as well. This of S2, this satisfies P, and this satisfies P. We don't know anything about this. Yep.
So supposedly, in the second formula, we replace the initial state with I11?
This is Macmillan's. We will go back. Yeah, very good. You had you could do it 15 years ago, and okay.
So independently and later.
Very late, yep. Okay, good. So here, so as I said, this is what we do. We take the intersection of the two approximation, and the other one, we just have it as is. And what we get here is a sequence of set of states. The first one over approximate S1, the second over approximate S2. Both of them satisfy P, and the successors of this are embedded in this set. And we can go on with this and compute another one, and so on. So now when we want to check whether we got to a fixed point, what we can do in principle, we can take the last interpolant that we computed, the one that we computed accumulated from all the previous sequences that we checked, and to check whether it is included, again, implication is inclusion, whether it included in the disjunction of the formulas. So here is here all of them are formulas, here all of them are really set of states. So I'm just going back to this, I showed at the beginning of the talk, and it says that the set of states obtained after J steps is included in the union of the set of states that I saw before, and if it happens, then I can stop. Here I do the same, but it's formulas, so I check whether IJ implies the disjunction of these formulas. So actually here and here I compute exactly the same. Or in other words, this is conceptually computing this, but not for SJ, but for the over approximation. And now this, surprisingly, can be checked with SatSolver. What we want to know here is that this formula is valid. But in order to check validity, we can negate the formula and send it to the SatSolver. And if it tells us that the negation is unsat, then we know that this formula is valid. So on the way, we saw that SatSolvers can prove validity as well. Satisfiability, unsatisfiability, and validity by negating the formula.
Question.
Yep.
But this formula is not in conjunctive normal form.
Not necessarily, but we often send the SatSolver formulas in any way. There is a pre-processing that transforms it. So here I'm cheating a little bit, but it's a little bit also difficult to explain the way it is really done. So I'll tell it in a higher level, not with all the details. First of all, I made a fixed point with a quotation here. And the point here is that I accumulate indeed set of states. But this set of states, usually when we compute least fixed point, we start with some set of states, and then it increases and increases and increases, and eventually we get to a least fixed point. This is the way we know to compute least fixed point. But here we get a set of states. So we got I1, and we got I2, and then we intersect it. So the states, the conjunction actually takes this and then this. And if we didn't intersect it, then we had a monotonic sequence of states. But actually here, since we shrink some of them, then we don't have real monotonicity. But still, it can be proven that if we get this formula, the result that this formula is valid, then we do know that we reach all the, we already saw all the reachable states and we can stop. We need to be careful because what happens is that we had this set of states and we checked that we don't have a fixed point here. This is the upper one. We don't have fixed point here and so on. But now when we add another set, in principle, we could only check this one because we know that these two doesn't have the fixed point property. But meanwhile, we change them. So it can happen that now any one of them has the fixed point property, and therefore we actually check all of them. So we go between all of them, the new set of states, ij, and we check for a fixed point. So this is a very subtle point, and it can be read in the paper, but it's important, but it cannot be conveyed with all details here. Yep. What I'm saying, I don't know if you can see the. You, oh, okay. So we'll redo it. So what happens in principle? I have one set. This is I1, and then I2, and I3, and whenever I3, and whenever I compute a new set, I check whether it's included in the previous one, and if I do, then I can stop. So I already checked whether this is included in this, and I checked whether this is included in this. So now if I add another one, I can, in principle, I can just check whether it is included in all these. So this is true if the these sets were stayed as they are. But what happened is that I shrink them in different ways. Because I intersect with the other interpolants that I get. And therefore, I need to redo the checks. So when if I find an inclusion anywhere, I know that I go to a fixed point.
It's possible that in the shrinking, I2 becomes smaller than I1.
Yes, yes.
Why do you do the shrinking? Suppose you didn't do the shrinking.
If I didn't do the shrinking, that then I wouldn't know that they satisfy P. So this is the main point. It's also...
All you need is the last one does not satisfy.
No, I want to know that everyone on the way do not satisfy, do satisfy P.
Why?
Because I want to know that I didn't hit a not P. And if I have an over approximation, I want to make sure that I do not hit a not P anywhere on the way. So now, actually what happens, what might happen, is that I increase the K, and now I come up with a new set of over approximation. And if I'm not careful, one of them can include a not P, and I didn't check it. So just to be on the safe side, not just to make sure that I get the right answer, I need to intersect it with the previous sets. Yes, but this is for the reachable states. And now I'm talking about over approximation. So what happens if I'm going back to the okay, let's stay here. What happens if here this is fine, it didn't contain any P, I checked it, but now I got a new formula, I got new over approximation. What happened if here the over-approximated state include not P? What I want eventually to say is that, and okay, and this state may appear later on as a real reachable state. And then I'll say, okay, I saw it, I don't need to check, I got to a fixed point and I'm fine. But no, because I saw it as an over-approximation and I didn't check whether it's it satisfies P or not P. Okay? Right, right. I always check when I check for fixed point. What I I take the union of all of them, the current one, and I check for inclusion of the new one that I just obtained.
And then it's not that ij over approximates the original state.
No, no, no. Ij over approximate sj.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why I can't use the over approximation that contained P?
Yeah.
Okay, so here I am going back to this one. What happens is that here I know that they do not contain P, but I didn't get to a fixed point yet. So I have to extend the formula and check whether there is a bug. I may find a bug of length 2, maybe. If I find it, then I stop and, okay. But if I don't find, then I find these new sets of interpolants. And for them, they are over-approximating. So here, all of them satisfy P, but this is a different over-approximation. And maybe one of them satisfy not P. And therefore, I need to intersect it in order to keep only those that, for them, I'm sure they don't. They satisfy P. Margaret? Okay. So now we can view again the analogy for forward reachability analysis. In principle, we would want to compute S1. Which is exactly the set of states reachable after one step. Instead, we will look at the formula for bound 1. We will find the interpolant, and we will get an over-approximation of S1. This will be I1, and we know it over-approximates S1 and satisfies P. Again, now we take okay, S2, we take the formula for K equals 2, we find the interpolation sequence, we intersect this one, we use just this the second one, and we get another, again, a sequence, each where the over approximation, as someone mentioned, this over approximate this, this over approximate this. Now I have, I think, another one, and okay. So this is the picture's view of what I'm doing here. I didn't understand, sorry. Okay.
And we further assume that P of V1, and conjunct P of V1 and P of V2 in this.
Yes, I do.
Then we can assure that the interpolation of I13 and I23 does not contain best states.
No, I cannot. Here I cannot. Only when I conjunct them up there. I know that this doesn't contain, this contains only P. Ah, okay. This is a very good point. Why didn't I'm return it to you. Why didn't I put not P of V1, not P of V2, only not P of...
put P of V1 and P of V2, since we already proved that for the first step and second step, property cannot be valid.
Oh, you want to put the P? Okay, but it's the same problem. Can you answer? You had an answer? No. Why? So the suggestion was to put here P of V1 and here P of V2, yep, and so on. Where will be the problem? On the way. So, okay, this is not so so bad because I really want, I proved already that I don't have bugs up to a certain point. And now I just want to extend it to see that I don't. But technically, what I will have now, one important property of interpolation in general is that if I cut it here, I get an interpolant on the intersection of the common alphabet. And if I add here the P1 and P2 and P3, then, for instance, if I take here the formula to the left and the formula to the right, they will include P1 and P2 and P3. The intersection between the formulas will include... just a moment.
Shortest path to
bug,
which is
PPPP
until not
P. Yeah. Ah, actually, okay.
You
so.
Have a problem with the requirement that IJ and TR and T implies IJ plus 1.
Yeah,
if you take something that holds it and just add not end the property for both, maybe now it's no longer.
Yeah, but at least for here. I will not be sure that all the states here are embedded here, because maybe. So the problem, yeah. So I think you have it right. Here I know that they are all satisfying P, but no. You know what? Maybe it's a good idea. I cannot see up front that it's not a good idea. I thought that it's a problem with the variables, but what you were suggesting will be okay for the partition, and maybe it's a good idea, and now in practice we need to check whether it improves or not, but it seems okay. Okay, so I have to really get in. Okay, so really quickly I want to explain also what Macmillan originally suggested. He had a different idea using interpolation. So we have again the interpolation. We know that here we have an over approximation of these states which represent, which do not have a bug using k minus one steps or less. Notice that for Macmillan, he could use this. He could say there is no bug in V1, no bug in V2, and so on, because he cuts it only here. For our case, we couldn't, because otherwise we would not be able, or when we cut the formula, we will get too many common variables. So for him, it's okay because of the way he cuts the formula. And now this is how it, he uses interpolation. He finds interpolation. Every time he checks whether there is a real bug. If there is a real bug, we stop. So he initially checked it. Now what he did, he took this set of interpolation and he plugged it here. And now what does this represent? Describe execution of what lengths? Two. Because these are reachable after one step, but it's over approximation. And now another step. So it describes a computation of lengths two. Then it gets an interpolation. It uses it again as the initial state. So now we are looking at computations of lengths three. And let's say that we now hit a bad state, then this bad state the counterexample might be spurious, because we didn't start from a real initial state, we start from some over approximation. So in principle, he could check whether this is spurious or not. What he does, he just increases the k and redo everything. So he increases the k to 2, plug in the original in it, and go over again and again and again, and so on. So the idea is just to replace the set of initial state to get an over approximation. Whenever we get a bug, we just increase the k, and we do have a check for a fixed point that we saw all the states, and this is the main idea. So, I think I don't want to do that. I'll skip this. I want to get to another point. Okay. I really want to get to another point. How do we compare the two methods? Actually, the two of them over-approximate the set of states, let's say S1, and then S2 and so on, but they over-approximate it in a very different way. So this means that in principle, the way they converge at different steps and for different reasons sometimes. And therefore, when we compare them experimentally, we actually saw that sometimes our method works much better, especially for falsification, because it has less overhead. For verification, if the formulas are very complicated, then we were doing better for simpler. Macmillan did better, and in principle, there are many methods developed over the, actually constantly, new methods are developed. None of them is an absolute solution, because the complexity of the problems is so high. So for what people do, for instance, at IBM, they have many machines, and when they want to solve a specific formula, a specific problem, they just send it to different machines with different solving methods, and whichever machine comes first with the result, okay, we got a result. So none of the existing methods in general is absolutely better than another one. Yeah. Sometimes, but not in this case. So we had if the bound is greater in order to reach verification, but it's very fragile because the bound may decide the bound of convergence when we prove correctness. It may depend on the algorithm that we use to compute interpolant, for instance, or the way the SAT solver works. Which influence this proof. So there are all kind of free parameters.
Okay. We need to stop because it's lunchtime, so
okay.